Would you like to master the most important section of QuickBooks that a contractor would need? Well, then you need to learn about the work to be done section of the contract and how it relates to your contractor items list. If you have any questions about this topic, you can leave them in the comments section below and I'll do my best to help you. And of course, if you feel the video helped you, I hope you will click like and don't forget to subscribe to get updates on new videos that come out all the time. Now, this is the items list that we have been using for the course. And if you remember, we set these items up at the beginning of the course when we set up everything for your contractor file. If you remember, these items are connected to income accounts that you had put in the chart of accounts when you originally set up the file. And you need several income accounts in your chart of accounts if you want to see a detail of the income section of your profit and loss. If you look at a typical QuickBooks profit and loss report, the income section is on top and the expense section is below. And if you want to see each area that money is coming in from, you would have to create separate income accounts so that those accounts would show up at the top of the profit and loss and show you how much money came into each of those income accounts to get the total income and then eventually subtract out the expenses for the net income. Now, how does the flow of information work? Well, you start by putting these items on an estimate because the estimate reflects the entire contract. And when you put the items on the estimate, it's at the beginning of the contract, so 100% of the amount you expect to bill for the entire contract is what gets listed on the original estimate. Then, when you bill the clients for each piece of the work that's done, you will only put on the items section of the invoice the amount of each item that was done during that specific phase of the job. And that's what you bill your client for. Now, in QuickBooks, the most important thing to remember is that it's the moment that you put the items on the invoice that the income accounts will increase. The income accounts do not increase when you create the estimate, and the income accounts do not increase when you finally get paid for the invoice. The income accounts that are connected to the items increase when you put the items on the invoice and save the invoice. So, where do they first come from? In other words, how do you decide what items to put on the estimate or invoice? Well, usually they come from a contract. And a contract, a written contract with a contractor for work to be done over several months, usually has several articles in the contract, and there are many pages of each contract. The most important section for purposes of this video is the section called Work of This Contract. That's really where you decide which items from your items list to put on the estimate and to put on the invoice and to bill in partial phases for progress invoicing. So these items, one by one, are actually explicitly stated on the contract. For example, under article number 2, the first description of work might be carpentry, and that would be the name of the item. And then in the contract, you would have something called a subdescription. And it's the subdescription that's written directly under the description of the item of work that really explains exactly what will be done regarding that item for each phase of the contract. For example, mason work. That might be the name of your item, but that might be the description of the title of that piece of work in the contract. And then, of course, in the contract, mason work would have a subdescription that clearly explains physically what the person is going to receive from the contractor for that specific item that will be billed as one of the line items in the invoices. The main description is the name of the billed item in the item column of the invoice, but it's the subdescription. That's what you use to decide how much of the work is done. And the subdescription goes in the description field on the same line of the invoice as the name of the item. For example, if the work on this contract called for two items, mason work and carpentry, and this was the description of the exact mason work you're going to do, and this was a description of the exact carpentry that you're going to do, how would it look on the invoice? Well, the title, mason work, which is the description of that piece, would go in the item code or item name column. And then the subdescription in the contract is what would go on the same line in the description field of the invoice. So you can see which or how many items of work in each section of the work done in the description of the contract. And for each item, you can clearly see in the description field exactly what the contractor is supposed to do in order to bill the client for that item of work. But then the question is, how do you know how much to bill for any particular phase of the job? Well, it's common sense. You would physically look at all of the work that had been done for that particular item since the last invoice, and you would count and you would use math, and then you would compare it to the subdescription exactly as it's written in the contract. And then you would decide for that particular invoice, for that part of the job, exactly how much to bill on that invoice, comparing the work to what it says on the job. Always consider what was billed in prior phases. We know that the estimate has 100% of each item listed for each item on the estimate. But if you only finished 25% of the work in phase one, you could only bill for 25%. But be careful. When you finish the next phase of the contract, you have to consider how much work is done in the prior phase, and most often you're required to show on that invoice how much work was done in all the work that was done actually in the prior invoices, and the specific amount of work that was done in this phase, and then after this invoice, the percent of the job that was billed and assumed to be physically finished. And it's only when you get up to the last invoice of the job that you can clearly see that you finished 100%. So in this example, phase three, 40% of the work was done in phase three, but this phase three invoice should have a column that shows the prior 60% finished and also show 100% finished at the moment you bill the final invoice. Billing for physical contracts can be detailed and complex. People outside the contract may need to evaluate the contract, but may not understand some of the details. It's safer to make a contract and the billing agreement in a standardized way. That's why our good friends at the American Institute of Architects have come up with a standardized way of classifying the different trade services and classifying the different items of service that they give, so contracts can be understood by objective parties and be a little bit more clear about each phase of the work done. Multi-million dollar contracts often require billing in AIA format. It's easier to settle disputes objectively, and it's easier to determine the billable amounts. Contracts that are in the format from the American Institute of Architects have standard sections called articles, and it's the work of this contract article that you have to sit down with your client and decide how to list it in the contract, the estimate, and the job invoices that you bill for. And one suggested way to match the items in the contract with the items listed in QuickBooks is to use the categories of trade services from the American Institute of Architects as your main items on your items list for your estimates and invoices. So, this is an example, this is actually an excerpt of a PDF that was published by the American Institute of Architects. This one only lists 5 trade items, but in the entire PDF from the AIA, there are about 30 or 40 different trade items. And trade items basically means what type of company and what type of certification the company has to perform the services that they perform when they make a contract with a client. It's possible that one company might provide more than one of these trade items, but usually it's one trade item per company because usually that's how they get certified. And the AIA lists a description of each of the typical services that would be listed in a contract under that licensure and under that certification. And for each description set for each trade item, you could use those standard descriptions as the categories of your items. And you could use the names actually as your items list. This will keep things standardized, and it will help objective parties understand the nature of the item so they can better understand what type of work should be done. And we will use as our example masonry. Now, I know nothing about masonry, but I know that you have to have a license for it, and I know that the American Institute of Architects lists these items of service that you would put on a contract if you had a contract with a mason worker company. And as you can see, this example shows you can take the defined items of services that the AIA has listed for masonry and actually make them the items on your items list. And if you do that, that means your estimates and your invoices will be just as clear as the contract itself. And you may be wondering, how does it look on an invoice? Well, this is what you could do. You would make, first of all, the name of the item that came a moment ago as the item code, and the specific thing that you will do for that job will go in the description field. Notice you could have the same item listed several times, but with a different description so that you know for these two brick and block work, these are the two things that are going to be done. For these three lintels, metal, and precasts, these are the three specific things that are going to be done. And that's how someone who is billing the client would know to look at the work done, look at the description field, and then determine how much to bill the client. You can learn everything you need in QuickBooks regarding contractor features by watching the full playlist that this video is a part of. You can just click the link in the comment field or under the first paragraph in the description field, and there's also links in the top right of the video as it plays.